Good morning, members. It is now 10 o'clock. We have got a quorum. I call to order the meeting of the Panel on Financial Affairs of the Legislative Council. This is the first meeting in the Year of the Horse. May I wish you a very happy Year of the Horse. Item 1 on the agenda, confirmation of minutes of meeting and matters arising. The minutes of the special meeting held on the 15th of November 2013 has been sent to members via CB Bracket 1, 8, 10, 13 to 14 to members, and the Secretariat has not received any proposals or amendments. If members have no particular comments on the minutes, could I ask that we confirm the minutes? Thank you very much. Item 2 on the agenda, information papers issued since the last meeting. After the regular meeting on the 6th of January, we have received two information papers and the details are in the agenda. If members have no questions on those, let us now discuss the date of the next meeting and items for discussion. The March regular meeting, if you remember, at our first meeting, we decided that it should be held on the 27th of February 2014. But it is not a long way from today, and we have had 3 to 4 items in these two last meetings, and therefore the administration has not put forward any item for discussion at that meeting. If members have no particular views, I would propose that since our March regular meeting, which is to be held on the 27th of February, and it is not a long way from today, I would propose that we cancel that meeting. So members, please also know that it is tentatively scheduled for a joint meeting to be held on the 18th of March together with the manpower panel to discuss the offsetting of the long service payment by MPF. And we will be meeting deputations. As you remember, some members asked the clerk to follow up the matter, and I myself proposed that since we are not going to have any March regular meeting, we can have that joint meeting with the manpower panel on the 18th of March. What do you think, members? Any views? Any questions? Great. Please block your diary. And the clerk will be issuing the notice of meeting to you in due course. So our next regular meeting will be held on the 7th of April at 10:45 a.m. We only have one item proposed by the administration so far, and this is a briefing on the latest measures to develop asset management business in Hong Kong. Members, if you have no other items to propose now, since we still have some time before we have that April regular meeting, you can continue to put in your views, and if the Bureau should produce any other items, we will be circulating those ideas around. If there is nothing else under this one, let us go into item 4, briefing on the work of the Hong Kong Monetary Authority. Let me now invite the administration team to join us. The usual practice is such that all members of the Council have been invited to take part in this discussion. The Hong Kong MA has produced a paper before the meeting, and that is in paper 804, bracket 03. And the Hong Kong MA will also be presenting a briefing kit to members, holding the briefing material. The administration team comprises Mr. Norman Chan, Chief Executive, Hong Kong Monetary Authority, Mr. Peter Pang, Deputy Chief Executive, Hong Kong MA, Mr. Eddie Yu, Deputy Chief Executive, Hong Kong MA, Mr. Arthur Yun, Deputy Chief Executive, Hong Kong MA. If you have settled down, Mr. Chan, the floor is yours. Please. Good morning, Chairman and members. I will be speaking to members on 5 areas in my report to you on the work of the Hong Kong MA in the last year. First of all, assessment of risk to Hong Kong's financial stability. This is a very important topic because the foundation of Hong Kong's commercial and business activities is our financial stability. Without that, we are in no position to talk about any economic development. Let us take a look at the global economy. When we look ahead, the most important factor is that the economy of the US will continue to revive, and the Fed has already decided to taper and ease its QE starting in the year, and recently that has been reduced by $10 billion. But does that mean that there will be smooth sailing for the entire world? Again, that is an important topic. Why do we have to talk about US, the Europe economy, China, and also Japanese economy? It is because we are an external-oriented and small-scale economy, and there is a lot of capital flowing through Hong Kong, and Hong Kong cannot avoid being affected and impacted upon by the global situation, and that is why we have to look at Hong Kong in that context. Let us talk about the U.S. The background to the U.S. decision to exit the market can be attributed to a few positive factors. The Fed, if the U.S. economy has not exactly revived, should not have decided to exit or withdraw from the market. But then there is a kind of growth momentum in the U.S. economy. The unemployment rate has fallen by 1.2% compared to a year ago, and its housing market has also recovered, and the prices have gone up by 10%. As for consumer spending, the growth has been 3.3% in the last quarter of last year. The Fed forecasts that the economic growth will continue to pick up and unemployment rate would continue to fall. By the end of the year, there will be an economic growth of 3% and unemployment rate will be at 6.5%. And also, there has been a fiscal deal struck between the Republicans and Democrats in December, resulting in a slight public spending cut for the next 2 years. However, in other words, this has been delayed. And in the coming 2 years, the discrepancy in dealing with the fiscal deficit will, in a way, much reduce the risk of having U.S. departments closed down because of a lack of budget. And the Hong Kong MA staff have analyzed that there are still hidden worries in the U.S. economy. So let me mention this. The business investments still remains weak. It is only 15% of GDP, and before 2006, it was 19%, so there is still a distance. As you know, business investment, especially by SMEs, would actually mean whether they would like to invest in plant machinery and hire manpower, but then the figures are still weak. The unemployment rate is 6.7%. It's not bad. But then the labor force participation rate has fallen. You can see this is at 62.8%, and it is a 35-year low. In other words, there are fewer people taking part in the labor force. That is why there is a fall in unemployment rate. It doesn't mean that the labor market is as good as it looks. As you know, there is a surge in U.S. equities, and S&P has risen by about 30%. But to a large extent, it is because of low interest rates, abundant liquidity, and share buybacks by large corporations. When there are share buybacks, there are fewer shares in the market, and so there is more profit for each share. And as I said, in terms of public finance, there is a delay in the public spending cut. However, the fiscal debt is still very high. It is at 100% more than the GDP. And then there is another hidden worry. When the Fed starts tapering, there will be less purchase of sovereign bonds. Now, of course, they can still have control on short-term interest rates. However, there will be less control and influence on long-term interest rates. What does this mean? Even if the Fed can maintain short-term interest rates as they are, it doesn't mean that the yield curve will not fluctuate because of supply and demand in the market. In other words, the long-term interest rates might rise higher and faster than is expected. Now I turn to Europe. There is only one slide on this one. After six seasons or quarters of contracting, the Eurozone has stopped to contract. In the second quarter, 0.3%, third quarter, 0.1%, it means there is almost no contracting. And also Ireland and Portugal, which have been quite heavily affected, now they have successfully returned to capital markets and with favorable response actually to their sovereign debt auctions, and the interest rate is at 3.7-3.8%. It means that investors have revived the confidence in these countries, and sovereign bond yields in most peripheral countries have fallen to pre-crisis levels. But again, there are concerns. The Eurozone unemployment rate is quite high. It is still at 12% overall, and for young people it is worse. It is over 20%. It seems there is not much hope of that coming down. And as you know, many countries are still doing fiscal consolidation, but then overall speaking, the public debt levels continue to climb as a percentage of GDP in many countries. And also, private and banking sectors remain heavily in debt. That is why even if the Europe Central Bank has suppressed the interest rate, however, in the private and banking sectors, there is still a tight supply in terms of credit, and this is not conducive to economic revival. Japan. Of course, there are positive development factors. The growth has accelerated. In the first three quarters of last year, there is a 3% year-on-year increase compared to 1.4% in 2012. That is a 100% increase. So there is a piece of good news. And inflation rate and inflation expectations have risen substantially. As the Japanese Central Bank has said that the QTE should be pushed to 2%. In December 2013, core inflation rate stood at 1.3%. So this is something positive. And also investor sentiment has improved, and Nikkei has risen over 30% in the last year. Let us talk about the concerns. The consumption tax hike was from 5% to 8% in April. Whenever there was a consumption tax hike in the past, there will be a negative impact on consumption and investment. Let us take a look whether there will be the same negative development when this happens in April this year. And then there is a long-standing problem, and that is the government debt stands very high. It is 2.5 times of GDP right now. And information shows that the government debt interest payments have mounted to 19% of government revenue. In other words, a fifth of government revenue is given away as debt payment. Now, is this high or low? It is not the problem. But as you know, the government debt, if it is a 10-year maturity period, it is only 0.6%. And if the inflation rate will really rise to 2% and international interest rates will also rise, then the Japanese government interest payment will be quite heavy. And this may have a negative impact on the economic growth in Japan. And as you know, the Japanese currency has depreciated. It was at 104, 105, and in these few days, 101. And this should be good for Japanese exports. But at the same time, there will be a negative impact on imports, and so there will be a widening of the deficit. Now, as you know, ABs, the Prime Minister, will always talk about the three arrows. One is the central bank's QE, two, fiscal stimulation, and three, structural reform. But the third arrow of structural reform has yet to be implemented. We have heard him say a lot about it, but we haven't seen any timetable for implementation.
As for the mainland, last year was pretty good. the GDP growth was 7.7%. And there were some major decisions made at the third plenum, such as a deepening of reforms and opening up of the market, and also that the market will play a decisive role in resource allocation with a view to enhancing the efficiency and stability of economic developments. Now, there is a risk which is attached to shadow banking, local governments borrowing, overheating of the real estate sector, and overcapacity problems. And these are concerns. Now, if the government is to eradicate overcapacity, and that is closing down some of the plants and facilities in the short term, this will be a negative for the economy. That would be obvious. And also, in order to restrict shadow banking and also restrict credit extension, that has to be done. But also, it will create certain credit tightness in the market, and that is a short-term risk. And further, internationally, if international funds exit China and emerging economies, that is actually a necessary step in the economic development. But again, for the short term, for the emerging economies, it will be a negative. Now, let us go to the global financial situation. The Fed in the U.S. has started its exit policy and scaled back asset purchases. Market initially reacted calmly or even positively before witnessing lately heightened volatility on worries of capital outflows. And there had been in the emerging market economies another round of capital outflow resulting in equity markets jitteries. Now, for the uncertainties of the global monetary and financial conditions, even though the US and Japan seem to be recovering in their economic conditions, however, there are still certain uncertainties and the strength and sustainability of their recoveries is still not proven. Now, if the Fed's policy of exit increases capital outflow from the emerging market economies, we are talking about Turkey, India, Indonesia, and Brazil. And in fact, these economies have been increasing their interest rates. And you would know that under such circumstances, it would actually hurt the economic growth. But they have no choice. Increasing the market interest rate is the only way the government see as stemming the capital outflow. So that is a macro situation. Let us go back to Hong Kong. And definitely, we're most concerned about the overheating of the property market in Hong Kong. And compared to November of last year, not much has changed in the sense that the property turnover had been slashed by 30 to 40% at its peak. And the prices have also decreased. And this is a chart familiar to you, the red line for prices of small to medium-sized flats, a blue line for large-sized flats. Now, the market prognosis is unclear, and we cannot be sure whether the upward cycle had come to an end, and we are looking at a downward cycle. We do not know yet. We will have to see, given time. And for banks' credit growth, there is a concern for residential mortgage lending. After six rounds of measures and policies, it has slackened down a bit. Last year, the growth was 3.9% for residential mortgage lending, which is moderate. But for other loans, the growth rate had been high, 18.4% in total. So overall, credit growth was 16%, and we believe that this is too fast. And therefore, the Hong Kong MA had come up with capital stability requirements, and that is for the banks, if the credit growth is higher than the average of all banks in Hong Kong, then they will have to ascertain the stability of their capital source. We do not want to see a situation as in 2008, 2009, where the banks had to, after extending credit, very quickly ask for repayment from the corporations and the clients. We do not want to see that. So that is for credit growth and stability. And as for growth in personal lending, from the chart, you'll be able to see that for personal lending, well, there are a lot of names for it. Some are in the form of tax loans and other personal loans. And for credit card loans, the rate of increase is much faster than the rate of increase of GDP. And the latest number is 370 billion. And compared to the year 2000, it was at 9.9% and 6.4% in 1990. And it now stands at 16.3%. Well, this is perhaps because of financial deepening that consumers and people are using credit cards and using bank loans. But on the other hand, this is a worrying trend, this growth in personal lending, because if we take this number and compare it with income, the ratio has been rising steadily. And we have issued a notice to all banks in Hong Kong urging them to exert more control in terms of risk management for personal loans. Basically, for the credit standing of the clients for personal loans, there should be more stringent consideration, such as the income of the persons taking out personal loans. There should be one of the factors of consideration, and also for properties mortgaged, that is personal lending without any property guarantee, those should also be more carefully considered. And also for the tapering and the interest rate, and where there are fluctuations, how would that affect the personal loan market? That is also something that we have asked the banks to consider in earnest. I would also want to talk about the counterfeit $1,000 Hong Kong notes. On 23rd of December 2013, we noticed certain counterfeit $1,000 bills, firstly from the Bank of China and then the Hong Kong Bank, and we have seized about 200 of such counterfeit notes. Well, they do have a fair degree of resemblance to the genuine notes, but after analysis, we have come to the conclusion that if citizens of Hong Kong pay more attention, these notes can be easily identified, in particular if they pay attention to the fluorescent barcode and the metallic thread. Now, if you can look at this photo here, the left-hand side, we have a genuine note, and on the right-hand side, a counterfeit note. Perhaps a projector is not as clear. You will be able to see more clearly on your computer screen in front of you. Now, for $50 or $100, you'll be able to buy a ultraviolet light to shine on the notes, and you'll be able to see the fluorescent barcode. And in the genuine note, it is very clearly revealed, but not for the counterfeit note. Now, for this very clear yellowish fluorescent barcode is not unique to the $1,000 note. Even for the other notes, such as a $20 note, you will also be able to see this very bright and clear yellowish fluorescent barcode, but that is not so for counterfeit notes. So that would make it very easy to identify the counterfeit notes. As for the metallic thread that was introduced in 2003, basically, in the manufacture of the paper for printing the banknote, this metallic thread had been woven into the paper. And we have on the left-hand side the genuine note, and you can see very visibly an uneven paper fiber edge. And we have printed on both sides of the paper. As for the counterfeit note, basically there are two pieces of paper which have been fused together, and then there is a thread which was inserted in between the two pieces of paper, which were later glued together to form the counterfeit note. But you will be able to see that the edges are uneven because the thread, the metallic thread, and the paper had been fused together, and therefore it is very different from the genuine note, which has a very clear paper fiber edge. So that is the difference between the two. And we have among the various countries around the world a very low rate of counterfeit, and which is basically 4 among a million. And for the banknotes dispensed over the bank counters or ATMs, they have been verified to be genuine, and therefore there is no risk of people of Hong Kong getting counterfeit notes through these means. And also we have introduced a new generation of counterfeit prevention. And in 2003, we and the banks have already sped up with the withdrawal of $1,000 notes, and we will be replacing the 2010 series with new notes, and we'll have more robust security features. And we have organized a number of seminars with 7,000 frontline employees from banks, retail businesses, and public services coming to these seminars to help them identify counterfeits. In fact, before coming to the seminars, they were apprehensive as to whether they are able to identify the counterfeit notes. But after attending the seminars, they're quite confident that it is actually pretty easy to do so. So if the public would like to get more information, they can contact us or go onto our Hong Kong MA website. And we have had 200,000 visits onto the counterfeit identification tips part of our website. So that is for your information. Yes, the Chief Executive. For this year, one of our major developments for the Hong Kong MA is to further develop Islamic finance. And in July, the government had already amended the loans ordinance to enable the issuance of Islamic bonds under the government bond program for further development. And also, we have also allowed for this sukuk or Islamic bonds to be issued in Hong Kong, reflecting that for the tax regime and also ordinances in Hong Kong can support the issuance of sukuk or Islamic bonds in Hong Kong, and that is very important for development of Islamic finance in Hong Kong. And also there is a joint forum on Islamic finance between Hong Kong and Malaysia. The first meeting was held in Hong Kong on the 3rd of December 2013, and the participants are from the private sector, and they are in support of identifying and encouraging potential fundraisers to issue sukuk and actively study the launch of Islamic funds. And also, a seminar on Islamic finance is to be jointly organized in Hong Kong by the Hong Kong MA and the Malaysia Central Bank in the first half of 2014 to promote awareness of Islamic finance in Hong Kong. As for retail payment initiatives for electronic bill presentment and payment EBPP service. It was already launched on the 11th of December 2013. And the scope of services include business to customer, that's B2C, and business to business, B2B, e-billing and e-payments, cross-border e-billing and e-payments, and also e-donation and presentment of e-receipt. And for mobile payment, the Hong Kong MA, together with an industry work group under the HKAB, have set out a set of common standards and guidelines to enable multiple payment services on a single NFC-enabled mobile phone and other devices. And this guideline was issued in November of 2013 for banks to follow.
And another important piece of work was to set up the legislative framework for stored value facilities and retail payment systems. From May to August last year, we conducted consultation and there was general support for legislation to be made. We are now consolidating the views collected during the consultation period, and refinements to the plan would be made, and then we are going to prepare for the drafting of the necessary bill. We have entered into the last stage of preparation, and hopefully we can introduce the bill to LegCo in the second half of the year. Next, I will briefly talk about a few measures on banking supervision. In our last work briefing, we mentioned how we could tackle financial instability or even collapse of large-scale financial corporations. And we need to reform the necessary supervision and legislative framework. This is because there have been a new set of standards after the financial crisis. Hong Kong is a member of the Financial Stability Board, and we need to follow the standards of the FSB to introduce the new standards by the end of 2015. After doing a comparison, Hong Kong is seen indeed to lag behind the present international standards. Members may know that on the 7th of January, the government has started the first round of public consultation, and the public would be asked a few major directional issues, and that is how we could reform the resolution regimes. Our target is that after the public consultation exercise, we hope that within the third quarter of the year, we can have the second round of public engagement, and we will be putting forward more concrete reform measures to gauge public views. As we said, the target of our work is to improve Hong Kong's legislative framework so that we can comply with the latest international standards. Now, this is most important if we want to maintain our international financial center status. Secondly, we would always update the progress of Basel III implementation at this panel. As you remember last year, we introduced the capital standards, and this year we will go to the second phase with regard to capital standards implementation. The main thrust is about the two concepts of capital buffers, which will be introduced, and secondly, with regard to domestic systematically important banks, we'd like to impose more stringent supervision controls, for example, to impose higher loss absorbency standards, etc. And we have to revise our capital standards in order to achieve these two purposes, and we will be tabling them for LegCo in the latter half of the year. Secondly, a new standard, the liquidity standard. After three rounds of consultation with the industry, we have more or less come to a consensus as to how the liquidity standards will be implemented. And in the first half of the year, we'll have to draft the necessary standards because these are a new set of standards. And hopefully in the fourth quarter, we can table them for LegCo's scrutiny. The clerk has asked us to also include a mention of octopus card in this briefing, and a particularly erroneous deduction of transport fares. We have seen three incidents of such in recent months. You may remember that one was caused by the upgrading of a bus company's card reader software by Octopus, OCL, so that cards that were read by those readers had a lower fare deducted from them subsequently. Yes, this is erroneous in that there has been a smaller deduction. However, we are still following up with the OCL as to whether they can improve their upgrading process. The other two incidents have to do with the MTR or LRT transport fares. After following up on the reports, we found that those problems had nothing to do with the operation of the OCL or upgrading of the software. Rather, the relevant transport operators, in fact, updated or upgraded their own backup systems for transport fares, and there were problems with those, so there was an erroneous deduction. So these were not within the control of the OCL because it had nothing to do with the OCL systems. The relevant transport operators are still dealing with the problem. Well, even so, with regard to the first case, we are following up with OCL, and they have already rectified the systemic error. But we will be looking at how future upgrading will be done in order to prevent a recurrence of the same. Chairman, now can I speak briefly on Hong Kong as an offshore RMB center? If you look at the left graph, you will see that there was quite a good development last year. This is about RMB trade settlement handled by banks in Hong Kong. Last year, it reached 384 billion and more. Compared to the 2013, there was a rise of 46%. And if you look at, again, the chart on the left, this is the total deposit, including customer deposit and certificates of deposit. By the end of last year, it reached 1053 billion. Compared to 2012, there was an increase of again 46%. Again, look at the chart on the right. This is RMB financing activities in Hong Kong banks. In terms of the RMB dim sum bonds, last year the issuance was up to 116 billion. It's more or less the same as last 2012, but then the outstanding loan stood at 310 billion, a rise of 30%. And then in 2013, the outstanding loans reached 115.6 billion. Again, that represented quite a handsome growth compared to 2012. This one shows the strengthening of Hong Kong RMB business links with other parts of the world. In the last year, we continued to do our promotion work in order to strengthen Hong Kong's status and role as a payment center. Together with London and Australia, we have established cooperation. But last year, we also entered into similar cooperation arrangements with Malaysia. Now, I won't go through all the figures here, but overall speaking, whether it be the participating banks on our platform, and also the amount of business transacted, there have been increases. And let's look at the last one, turnover in Hong Kong's RMB real-time gross payment system. There has been almost 100% growth, and it stands at about 400 billion every day. So this shows that that is deepening in terms of RMB business between Hong Kong and other parts of the world. Let me now talk about the investment performance of the exchange fund. Last year, the overall investment environment was quite uncertain and was unstable, especially in terms of the bond market and interest rates. There have been a lot of uncertainties. In May, June last year, the Fed implied that there could be a chance of tapering or withdrawal from the market. There was strong reaction from the market. The 10-year federal debt increased sharply, and throughout the year it rose by 127 basis points. And if you invested in bonds, you would suffer loss, and also there was a lot of volatility in the equities market. But it, overall speaking, the year performed well, especially the European and US markets. These would reflect in the investment income for us. If you look at the leftmost column, this is the income for 2013 in terms of Hong Kong equities, 10.1 billion. Other equities, meaning overseas equities, 71.6 billion. In terms of bonds, there was a loss of 19.1 billion. Other investments, including private equity funds and also investment in real estate, a profit of 11.7 billion. Foreign exchange, because of the good performance of the euro, 1.6 billion, altogether 75.9 billion. The return rate is 2.7% for the entire exchange fund. As for investment portfolio, it is 4.9%. The backing portfolio, a slight loss of 0.4%. From this chart, let us look at the middle. It records payment to fiscal reserves for 2013. It stands at 36.8 billion. How is this calculated? We use a fixed rate of fee payment. This is from 2007 to 2012. We'll look at the average investment income of our portfolio. And in 2013, it stands at 5%. In this chart, we have always seen that the exchange fund should be looked at in the long term, and let us look at the exchange fund in the medium and long term. This is from 1994 up till 2013. As I said, in 2013, the investment in income rate was 2.7%. If you look at the entire situation from 1994 to 2013, the compounded annual investment return was 5.4%, and that is higher than the compounded inflation rate. Now let us talk about investment diversification. We introduced to you this in the past. We started to do this in 2008, and last year we moved emerging market bonds and equities to this investment diversification. We call this the long-term growth portfolio, and they are made up of mainly by private equity and real estate. In the last year, in terms of private equity, the market value stood at 64.2 billion and real estate 24.4 billion, altogether $88.6 billion. The annualized return since inception, well, actually, outstanding investment commitments at the end of 2013 amounted to $81.3 billion. Now, this is about long-term investment, and its liquidity is not as good. So the short-term investment return may be volatile. So let us look at the long-term investment return. Starting from 2008 to the end of last year, the annualized return, if you look at it as internal return rate, it stands at 15.9%. And this is higher than that at the end of 2012. This is because there was good performance in terms of individual investment projects, and also there was good performance in the global equities market last year. However, this may not always be the case. Okay, maybe I should stop here. Okay, now it's the time for members to ask questions. 11 members have indicated interest to speak. I will now let you know the order. Leung Kwan Yin, Wong Kwok Eng, Chen Kam Lam, Lam Kin Fong, and then Sin Chung Kai, Ho Chen Yen, Chang Wah Fong, Leung Kai Chang, and then myself, and then Chen Kin Po. I would say 3 minutes each, so please be brief in both your answers and questions. Mr. Andrew Leung. Just now, the CEO said that last month there was outflow of capital from emerging markets. Luckily, Hong Kong was not exactly impacted upon, even though there was volatility in our equities market. Mr. Chan, if the U.S. continues to scale down its debt purchase, how would you project the outflow of capital from Hong Kong? Would there be a sharp rise in interest rates so that there would be some concerns about Hong Kong's economy?
Thank you for the question, Mr. Leung. In the past 1 to 2 weeks, there had been certain volatility in the equities market. But if we look at funds flow, there had not been major in or outflow. But for the other emerging markets, such as Turkey, Indonesia, India, they have come under certain pressure. My own assessment is that if the U.S. economy's pace of picking up is good, as we saw yesterday, the employment rate, and there will be further employment rates coming out soon, then the tapering policy of the U.S., it will continue to exert pressure on the emerging markets in terms of cash or liquidity outflow. For the economists, in the past 3 to 6 months, their assessment of emerging markets had been changed quite fundamentally. This is not overnight, but rather compared to, let's say, 4 to 5 years ago, they had been very favorable looking at the emerging markets, including China, but that has changed. So this is not something that is purely in reaction to one or two cycles or volatility of the market, but rather they are looking at the continued recovery and growth of the U.S. economy. And for the emerging markets, there have been a lot of capital inflow into their markets in the past years to the tune of thousands of billions of dollars. And in the past, if they take this capital out from the emerging markets, there's nowhere else to invest the money. But that's no longer true. The U.S. The economy is growing with a lot of innovation, such as shale gas, etc. So for ourselves, for Hong Kong, our fundamentals are good compared to many of the emerging markets. But you have to remember, in the last quarter of 2008 to 2009, there had been a lot of US dollars inflow into our market. And in the normalization of interest rates, this capital will flow out of Hong Kong. And that is regular and that is normal. So to come back to Mr. Leung's question, where there is a lot of liquidity in the market, the interest rate will be low and there will be a lot of credit lending. And going forward, I do see pressure in terms of interest rates and also credit extension. And I have urged people time and again to be very clear about their repayment abilities and not borrow just because there is cheap money. I'm looking at the chart in the presentation. It says in your slide 5 that market interest rates may react greater and faster than the normalization of monetary policy. Mr. Chan, I would like to ask you, for Hong Kong in the coming year, we may experience major interest rate hikes. I would like to know from you what you think the property market performance would be given that, and also for personal loans market, how would that be impacted? From the chart on page 12, we see that there is growth in personal lending and the growth is too fast. Can you respond to that, please, Mr. Chan? Thank you for the question. For the Fed, basically, they have focused on controlling the short-term rates. But since the 2008 financial crisis, apart from this, they have also resorted to purchasing long bonds and therefore affecting the yield of long bonds. And the 10-year treasury was as low as 1.6% at one point, which was a historic low. but as the Fed stopped purchasing bonds, their ability to affect the long bond rate has been negatively impacted. And for the 10-year Treasury, it came up to 2.6 to 2.7% from 1.6-1.7%, that is. So that is 100 basis points up. And that reflects that for the remainder of this year or next year, for long bond rate, the Fed's influence would be less. And that is a process that is a normalization process. Now, as for the wholesale interest rate for Hong Kong, it is much affected by capital in and outflow of Hong Kong. But when it comes to personal loans or bank loans to corporations, that is affected by supply and demand. If there is sufficient capital in the banks, they would seek an exit. You remember 2 to 3 years ago, the rate foreign rate was 2 to 3%, but that, or under 2% at one point, but that is no longer the case. It is higher. And that is because of supply and demand. So whatever the loans, the liquidity of the banks will be affected, and also the interest rates of the banks will be raised where there is less liquidity, less capital. So as capital exits Hong Kong and the emerging markets, yes, it will present pressure for the Hong Kong interest rates to be raised. Mr. Chen Kam Lam? Yes, Mr. Chen and his colleagues have talked about the macro situation, and in particular the China, US, Europe and Japanese economies. We see that the mainland economy, compared to the other countries, is performing particularly well. Mr. Chen, you have also mentioned just now that there are certain concerns with the U.S. economy and its recovery, and the Fed may taper off in the near future. And this will impact Hong Kong. And you have also voiced that we should pay attention to interest rates, possible interest rate hikes, and its impact on the property market. Because the US dollar may strengthen and the Hong Kong dollar may also reevaluate, how do we handle this? Basically, we have 400 billion of turnover vis-a-vis the RMB, and that is a large amount. And every day, Hong Kong people, for their exchange from Hong Kong dollars to RMB, there is a cap to that. And this also affects the trade and also the between Hong Kong and the mainland. I would like to know from Mr. Chan whether this cap of 20,000 Hong Kong dollars would be taken off. Will you be talking to the central government about that? And also, in the latest rounds of meetings with the central government, in fact, this point had been raised. What is the timetable so that we can facilitate the better cooperation and coordination of Hong Kong and mainland China? Well, actually, not too long ago, the economists have raised concerns about the economic development in China, in particular with respect to shadow banking, local government borrowing, etc., that these should be handled and dealt with. Otherwise, they are sources of concern continuously. But basically, the same people are also saying that by handling and dealing with these problems, it is also eliciting certain concerns. So our assessment is that these risks need to be dealt with. But as mentioned just now, such as overcapacity, the government will have to deal with them. But in the short run, there will be more unemployment because people would lose their jobs. And there are certain productions and facilities which will have to cease. But on the other hand, these issues have to be dealt with nevertheless. And that is to say, in the short run, there may be certain pressure, but for the medium to long term, these issues and problems must be dealt with and there must be reform to eradicate them. Now, as for Mr. Chan's question about the $20 exchange cap for Hong Kong dollar and RMB, in fact, last year I have raised this to the Hong Kong AB, and the PBOC is also considering this at the moment. And whenever we have meetings with the PBOC, we raise this as a possibility. Hopefully, they will come back with a very positive and clear response. Yes, we would welcome any other venue for raising this. Mr. Lam Kin Fong? Yes, Mr. Chan was talking about the international economic arena, and there are positives as well as concerns. We have seen some good news, but are they here for stay? The US, Europe have been positive in certain aspects, but on the other hand, there are certain concerns such as the effect of the U.S. recovery on credit and liquidity, and there may be problems there. Now, for businessmen, the Americans, the Europeans, if the economy is doing well, they want to do more business, of course, they turn to the banks for loans. But if the loans are not forthcoming or difficult to come by, then what will they do? They, of course, put pressure on the Hong Kong manufacturers and exporters. They will not pay up as soon as we would like them to, and that would present problems for us. And also, money or capital will be maybe repatriated back to Europe and the US. I do not know whether the latest round of jitteries was because of that. But basically, we will look very closely at market development, but that is not sufficient. I think we should have certain measures ready. The export market and the impact on manufacturing, etc. Given that, what do you think our banks should do? Credit assessment, for example, and credit risk assessment. What exactly should our banks do in that regard? And also, you talked about return on investment. The figure was not that encouraging in December, but the year does not end until the 31st of December. I would like to know about your forecast, given your knowledge on the latest numbers. For the export market, for manufacturers, whether they are big or small, we'll really have to look at the demand, that is, the buyers. For the U.S., economic recovery is a good thing because it will present more orders. As for Europe, yes, it may be slower, it may be weaker, but on the other hand, it is at least not contracting, and therefore the orders or purchase orders would not contract. Now, as for credit, I'm not saying that it will become even tighter, but for Spain and Greece, these countries, the unemployment rate is very high, and among the young people, it is as extremely high, and it is very difficult to turn back the clock to pre-financial crisis situation. As for the central banks, they are loosening, but on the other hand, the commercial banks, they are still very tight with their credit. So that the benefit is not passed on to the commercial sector or the corporates. But given the capital basis in Europe, I am not pessimistic. So for what about Hong Kong banks? What should we do? As Mr. Lam had pointed out, credit assessment. even if you're flushed with capital, the banks will have to consider how they extend loans. Of course, they would want to make more loans, but on the other hand, there are risks concerned. Now, 3 to 4 years where there was a lot of credit, whether it is US dollars, Hong Kong dollars, deposit far exceeded loans. That is no longer true. For Hong Kong dollars and US dollars, it is now 80%. That is to say, for $100 deposit, some $80 are extended as loans.
So the banks have to watch the liquidity more closely. I don't know whether Arthur would like to add, but I think it's almost time. Next member, Ng Leung Sing. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to thank the Hong Kong MA people for their introduction. As we know, there were around a few rounds of QE. Now there is the tapering schedule, and again there will be an impact. I remember in 1998 when the Hong Kong government entered the market in order to fight off the speculators. We were criticized by the US, but then the US had done something that is affecting the entire world. My question is, we know that private loans are climbing from 2007 to 2013. There has been an upsurge. Now, of course, there are many reasons for that, and those have been mentioned. But my question is, should we do more analysis on the use of the loans? Because this may affect the public as a whole, and then the Basel Committee. The identification of GSIBs. I'd like to know whether there will be a concrete consultation timetable, and will you go for more stringent standards than those adopted by Basel III? Can I defer to Mr. Yun to take those questions? Yes, number one, private loans. You can see from this chart that the total is at 370 billion. It is made up of by two parts. One relating to credit cards. About one third of that relates to credit cards, and two thirds are for private use loans. And as Mr. Chan said, a part of them are tax loans, but others are really just private loans. Very often, there may not be specific uses for these private loans unless they are really specific. If it is a car mortgage or higher purchase, then we know those we have figures for. But we cannot see any particular part being a part of this big private loan volume. For GSIBs, how we can identify them, we are drawing up a policy. Now, Mr. Ng was talking about GSIBs. Now, that has been launched, and it is an international standard implemented by the Financial Stability Board. The policy that we are drawing up is about systematically important financial institutions which are domestic. We will take reference from that framework, but we are not going to just transport it to Hong Kong because we have to be mindful of the local situation. The consultation timetable is that we are consulting the banking sector. Hopefully within a few weeks, we can consult the industry. Next, Mr. Sim Chung Kai. Chairman, I have two or three questions. Number one, slide number 12. You say that the growth in private loans is worrying, but do you have the default rate? Do you see any rise in that? Is that cause for worry? And secondly, I am worried about investment diversification of the exchange fund. You are investing in private equity, and you have also purchased real estate in London. Do you have any internal investment guidelines? to ensure that you are doing the proper thing. You are talking about an IRR of 15.9%, meaning that the investment is of high risk and also the return will also be of high risk. I'd like to know how you are keeping financial prudence. And also, number three, the 1,000 denomination counterfeit notes. It is fortunate that before the Chinese New Year, not many such counterfeit notes have been discovered, but still shop owners are refusing to accept those notes. You say you will speed up the replacement of the 2003 series. When can that be completed? Okay, I will answer the third question, and I will ask Arthur and Eddie to take up the first three. Mr. Sin, we are not exactly phasing out the 2003 series. As I said, the counterfeit notes this time around do look very authentic, but as I said, they can still be identified. And of course, I know that small shop owners, including newspaper vendors, in fact put up a notice to say they refuse to accept these notes. Now, we have sought an understanding into this. In fact, before there were these counterfeit notes, newspaper vendors would just not be very happy to accept $1,000 notes, even if they did not put up that notice. And now, since there are these counterfeit notes, they would say with a bigger voice that they don't like these counterfeit notes. And with our publicity and talks, which have reached 7,000 people, and also with our APIs, we hope that more people will find these notes acceptable. There is a circulation of 110 million such notes in the market. Now, if we would collect them in the banks, if they are not exactly torn or badly worn, we will reissue them to the market. But there is no question of stopping the circulation of the 2003 series, because if you say we phase them out, then there would be more people who would refuse to accept them. But then the chain stores now have no problem accepting the 2003 series. I don't know whether there is time for the other two questions. As I said, there are different types of personal or private loans, so there will be different default rates. Generally speaking, it is at 1 to 2%. This is the default rate. Our view is this may not be very accurate in any way, because the interest rate is unusually low. I like to talk about investment diversification. Mr. Yin Sin, you are correct. We are very mindful of risk control, and we have a cap. It is 1/3 of our accumulated reserve. So it should only be 210 billion Hong Kong dollars. We do due diligence tests for every item. There will be project and item management, and also each is vetted by an investment committee headed by Mr. Norman Chan. So we exercise a lot of caution. Next one, Mr. Albert Ho. Mr. Chan, I think your colleagues and you are aware that there are more advertisements taken out by deposit-taking companies. They are also under your regulation. I'm sure this is because they have good business, since they are spending so much money on advertisement. But in the past past year or so, I have received more complaints about how they manage their business and how they promote their business. Say an old person has lived in a house with his or her partner, and the mortgage has been paid off, and then suddenly someone would visit them to ask them to mortgage half of the property, and a loan is extended to them. And if you want to have advance repayment of the loan, then there would be a high handling charge, and of course the interest rate would not be low. It would be 3% or something. And problems have been caused for many families, because they have been persuaded into taking out the loan. And secondly, the service payment, service contracts serviced by installments, whether there you are talking about the gyms or other businesses, if you agree, they will get a deposit-taking company to get all the money, and then the deposit-taking company would say the person concerned has taken out a loan, whether the service is indeed delivered as promised, and whether there is a contract, the deposit-taking companies do not care. I'd like to know how many complaints you have received. I can present my own figures, but if you do not do more stringent regulation, there would be many more victims. Mr. Chen, thank you. Mr. Ho, we are aware of the problem. We do see that some of the advertisements can be quite exaggerated. I will ask Arthur to speak in a moment. But most of the deposit-taking companies do not come under our regulation. No, unless they have got an authorized institution license, and if they accept deposits, then they are under our regulation. But some DTCs do not come under us. However, they have business with banks. In other words, they borrow from banks, and through the banks, we can understand more how they go about their business, and we can certainly express concern. Arthur, can you answer those questions? In fact, I have also received many of that kind of complaints. Can we refer them to you? But as Mr. Chen said, in the evening, you see these high-profile advertisements. These DTCs come under the moneylenders ordinance. They do not come under our regulation. Okay, I understand, but because of the lack of time, can I just ask you this? These are financial activities to a certain extent. If you go to the police, they will just try to see whether there is triad participation, but I think you should review the entire system. Mr. Chen, yes, this is a fundamental issue. The banking ordinance gives us powers to do supervision, but we only look at that on the basis of deposit taking. Whether you call yourself a bank, if you accept deposits, you will have to take out a license because we want to protect the deposits made by the public. But in terms of loans, our philosophy all these years is that as long as you can get the a source of funding, whether it comes from your shareholders, etc., then I do not actually regulate them because there is no question of protecting the interests of depositors. But then we can go back and talk within the government because giving out loans is also a financial activity. Whether the framework now afforded by the moneylenders ordinance is adequate should be looked at. Indeed, yes, this is a problem that worries many people. I hope you will really take a look. Next question by the Deputy Chairman. Thank you. The Fed has announced that there will be a tapering schedule, and that means there will be a capital crunch in the market. And developing countries have seen interest rate volatility and also volatility in their stock markets. My question for Mr. Chen is that there will be challenges for Hong Kong as well, you said, and also there has been volatility seen in the Hong Kong stock market. Mr. Chen, the SFST, said that there could be the risk of capital outflow. Well, we haven't seen that happen yet, but Mr. Chen, what is your assessment of the risk of capital outflow? If this indeed should happen, what will be the impact on our property and stock market and also our exchange rates? Recent developments have shown that there may be some possibility of Hong Kong increasing our interest rates ahead of the US. And also in September this year, you will have come to the end of your term. Will you seek another term to serve the public? Also, you are the head of the Hong Kong MA. Do you think that your holding of the position should be considered as a risk for the Hong Kong public in looking at their investment? I don't know whether I have time. I'll give you all the time you need. Well, the present tapering schedule of the U.S., well, in fact, it does not equate to the credit crunch. In fact, the asset liability sheet is still expanding. In fact, it's still purchasing debts from the market. It's just that the scale has been reduced, but then the market does not exactly react as Fed would like it to. And in the past 2 weeks, again, there has been a lot of volatility in the U.S. market as well. So the challenge is not just whether you have achieved the effect of entering the market, but then the challenge is also about exit from the market without causing volatility. And that would, in fact, be the way to assess the success or otherwise of the QE exercise. And if we start to get prepared only now, it would be too late, Mr. Zheng. The first round of counter cycle supervision started in 2009. We started to do it because we started to see the effects of QE. And of course, if we only try to dampen the property market now, it would be too late, because once there is an outflow of capital, the interest rates in Hong Kong will go up, because interest rates in the US are going up, and that will be the case for Hong Kong as well. And this is only normal when there is an outflow of capital. So we have to be careful. Even if you have got a 1% interest rate when you take out the mortgage, be very careful. Don't assume that it would continue, because it would not be the case for the next 30 years. This is the first point. I think I do not have more time, but if you are happy to say something about your personal future, we'll be happy to listen to you.
Yes, the appointment is a very important topic, and I'm sure the FS will be very cautious, and at the right time there will be the right announcement. Well, my question is, Mr. Chen, do you still want to serve the people of Hong Kong? Do you have that heart? Madam Chair, I have nothing to add. Mr. Liang Kai-chang? Thank you. Mr. Chen, in your CB bracket 1, 804, 1314, 04, I'm looking at slide 52 in particular, concerning credit growth. Not the summarized one, but the full version, credit growth, slide 52. For Q1 to Q3, we see clearly that there is significant credit growth, and you actually had to write to banks to remind them of liquidity risk management and the stable funding requirement, which was about to be implemented. Is it because the banks were not aware of these requirements that you had to write them? Or is it because there were certain systematic or systemic risks you noticed? And also, for such high credit rates, it is because of cross-border lending. How much is cross-border credit as a percentage of total credit portfolio in Hong Kong? That's the first question. The second question, in your presentation just now, you have not really talked about the sovereign debt crisis in Europe. Can you perhaps give us a summarized assessment of that, please? Mr. Chen, yes, perhaps a second question first. Arthur will answer the first question. Concerning the European debt crisis, the peak, at its peak, what were we worried about? For Greece, Spain and Italy, where they were near collapse, we feared that the Eurozone may actually itself collapse. But Mario Draghi, the central banker, had many times very clearly reiterated that he has a number of measures, specific tools that he could use, and he did use, to ascertain that the Eurozone would not collapse, and therefore the risks have subsided substantially, but for the financial system and its collapse, even though that has been ameliorated, but it doesn't mean that the economy would be smooth sailing from here onwards, because a number of economic systems are still under significant pressure, such as 25% of unemployment rate. Even if it's reduced to 10%, there will still be 16% of cut. Where does the impetus come from for fueling the economy? Now, if the banks are tight, you know, if credit is not forthcoming, even where there are businessmen who want to make investments, where does the credit or the capital come from? So I think it is still a worrying situation. It is not to be resolved in 2 to 3 years. Arthur? Yes. Concerning cross-border credit, as a total for Hong Kong banks, it is about 30%. But this is a comparison with the total. In fact, for the past few years, the growth at different times, but most of the time it would be coming from the local market, that is from Hong Kong itself, in terms of credit growth. Does it show that the banks are not clear about the liquidity risk controls? Well, actually, there are a number of ways of going about it. There are a number of indices that they can use, and we have made those clear to the banks, and the banks also have their own internal guidelines. In the at the end of Q3 last year, we came up with certain very clear specific indices for the bank's reference. It is not to suppress credit growth, but rather, if there is to be credit growth, that it is on a sustainable basis with sufficient funding to support that credit growth. We do not want to see where the economy turns, that they will have to demand immediate repayment. Mr. Chen, Paul? Yes. I'm looking at the increase of bond valuation. We know that as interest rates increase, a bond valuation should come down. But of course, if you hold to maturity, you will not stand to lose. But given your large bond portfolio, I would like to know how you would want to reduce loss when interest rates increase, or in fact, how we can make money out of this opportunity. Yes, indeed. Bond funds and bondholders stand to lose at interest rate hike environment. But and even if we hold to maturity, in fact, it will be we will be at a loss. So how do we ameliorate that situation? Hold cash or near cash? That is one possibility, so as to avoid the loss. But are we sure that the interest rate hikes would be significant? For example, we said that the U.S. economy has certain concerns, and Mr. Bernanke had said last year that it is data dependent. That is, if the economic data are good, then we may lower the debt purchase. But on the other hand, if it goes the other way, he may increase his purchase. That is, the tapering can be stopped or it can be slowed down. So no one has a crystal ball to know how the interest rates would perform. Yes, for the Treasury bonds, it is 2.6% at present, 10-year bond, U.S. Treasury. So the difference, well, if we hold cash, it is 0% income, and the difference is 250 basis points. That is 2.5%. So you cannot hold all cash. But if you do not hold cash, you do not hold bonds, what do? Well, you hold equities. The S&P had been rising some 30%, and that is very encouraging. Hong Kong stock market rose only 3%. So is it true that the equities market will definitely rise, that it is safe? Well, no one can tell you that. No one can say that the U.S. economy is performing well and the stock market will be going up. So if we weigh all these considerations, I can only say that for this year, the investment environment is very difficult to foresee. And if we can preserve capital, that is already a very good result for this year. Ms. Regina Yip. Again, I would like to talk about the exchange fund rate of return. Thank you, Mr. Chen, for responding to my plea last time and providing us with more information concerning this. Yes, the FS had also commended you, saying that in the past 5 years or so, there had been some 5% return, even though this year had been, or the past year had been less encouraging. I would like to know why there is such high fluctuations in terms of rate of return from 12% to, well, sometimes negative. Mr. Chan, I think since you have come to the post, the returns have decreased. That may not be due to you, but because of the financial crisis and the general investment environment. Can you respond to that question, please? Further, because we are pegged to the US dollar, do we basically focus on US dollar asset? How much of our portfolio is in U.S. dollar asset? How much in emerging markets? How much in the mainland market? What is the distribution and allocation? Is it true that, as some newspapers have pointed out, that you have come up with a sovereign wealth fund or a quasi-fund in fund in order to diversify your investments? Is that true? First of all, on allocation, Eddie can supplement on that. As for the rate of return, if you look at the 1994, starting from 1994, we have made open our investment results, and our highest was in 1998. It was at over 12%, the rate of return. And in the past, we have not held a lot of Hong Kong equities, but as we went into the market in 1998, it has increased our rate of return. And before then, it was about 5 to 6% in terms of returns. It was for a special reason that it went all the way up to 12% in 1998. But when we have a portfolio that is diversified, that is equities, bonds, and apart from Hong Kong equities, we also had overseas equities as well, became more diversified. The question was, why had the rate of return decreased since I came to the position, if I can respond to that? In fact, before I came to the position, there was some 700 to 800 billion US dollars coming into Hong Kong, and we have put them into the backing portfolio, which could only be put into very safe short-term instruments such as US treasuries. And when the time came for the lowering of interest rates from the US, that is all the way to almost 0%, this 1,200 billion, which had zero return, and last year it was actually negative 0.4% return. Given that, and on the other hand, for the long-term portfolio, we had 4% or 4.9%. But if you have a portion of your portfolio fetching such very low return, it would affect the overall return. And these 1,000 billion or so, they may flow out of the, they may flow out. So we have to have that kind of stability. And the U.S. Treasuries would not be always at 0% or close to 0%. It may be fetching 3% or maybe 3 to 4%. If that is the case, then the returns overall would be better. the US dollar allocation is 79% and non-US dollar allocation is 21% for our stability fund. As for the mainland, we have 30 billion RMB as our quota, and for QFII, it is 1.5 billion US dollars, and we have used up that amount, and we will be talking to the PBOC for increasing that quota. As for diversification of our portfolio, there is 80 billion US dollars of private equity as well as real estate investment. And these are assets or asset types that sovereign funds around the world invest in. Mr. Wong, please. I would like to know about counterfeit notes. From the end of last year to now, the Hong Kong MA had received seized 250 $1,000 counterfeits. I would like to know how this has actually impacted the Hong Kong market. The note issuing banks, for instance, do they have certain measures to combat this? I also noticed from Mr. Chan's presentation just now that the 2010 1,000 note series would be used to replace the 203 series. I would like to know about the process and where you're at in terms of that replacement. For the counterfeits, to answer the question, in fact, it was discovered by us just before the Christmas time. And in the past, we would seize 900 to about 1,000 of such counterfeit notes. But for this time, it is slightly different from before in terms of the quality of the counterfeit notes. We have done work in various areas. First of all, together with the banks, we have been educating the shops and the businesses as to how to identify the counterfeit notes.
Now, if they cannot be identified, then of course there could be the spread of fear. But as I said, it is not difficult to discover these counterfeit notes as long as you look carefully. But then, of course, the public are still disturbed. They don't even want to use an ultraviolet light. They were saying whether they could exchange the 2003 series with the 2010 series because there are more anti-counterfeit features. In fact, the banks have done a lot in order to have a reserve of 2010 series for replacement by the public. But then some say, I don't even want to have a $1,000 denomination notes. We would just like to use $500 denomination notes. Why not? And then the banks also had got a great reserve for that. But then, if there are many people queuing up for converting their $1,000 notes, then they will have to spend longer time in the queue. And also, when you put in deposits now, the bank staff have to check the notes, and perhaps that would again take a longer time. We cannot expect a total disappearance of counterfeit notes. No matter how advanced your technology is and how good your design is, the counterfeit notes will always appear sooner or later. But then we always have to be ahead of them. In this time around, the 2003 notes have been counterfeited, but then we have the 2010 series, which can hardly be counterfeited. But then if shop owners refuse to accept the $100,000 notes, would that violate any laws? Mr. Chen, no. I can ask Peter to explain. Yes, a short explanation. In fact, Mr. Wong, we have had that explanation already before. This is a legal tender, and between the buyer and the seller, they can decide on what legal tender to use for settlement or payment. So there is no contravention of any laws. Lastly, my own questions. I'd like to follow up on the investment income this year. After that has been published, the newspapers have commented that compared to last year, there is a big drop. But to be fair, we should not just compare this year with the last, because investment returns do tend to fluctuate. Just now, I did some calculations. Let us look at 2009. Let us not look at 1998. But the four-year average is still higher than that for last year by 7%. And if we use the IRR, if we look at 2009 to 2012, a four-year average, and compare that with this year, a comparison between 3.75 and 2.2, again, we have not fared that well last year. Mr. Chen has said that the investment environment has been difficult, but then compared to the four-year average, we still have fared worse. So what is your final remark, apart from the environment being difficult? Would you attribute this to other reasons? Mr. Chen Kin Po was talking about the bond portfolio. I agree with him because bonds are relatively safer and we should not just look at 1 year's investment return. I don't think there should be a lot of changes made just because we endured a loss last year. However, I'd like to ask you this. This figure includes two parts, according to my understanding. One, the realized gain, and two, the change in valuation. In fact, I'd like to know the apportionment of these two parts in that figure of loss in bonds. And then when you say other equities, do you mean equities outside Hong Kong? Now, according to your investment portfolio, you have made a lot of profits this year. But why? Is it because Hong Kong stocks were not adjusted because of a change in valuation or what? Thank you, Chairman. Let me answer the last question first. Let us look at our report card for 2013. Equities have fared quite well last year. Even if the European economy is facing a lot of challenges, their equities have done well, 20 to 30% rise, whether it is Germany or France, and US S&P a rise of 30%. But then Hong Kong equities were not that good. There was only a 3% rise, even if the global situation was good. So if you only dealt in Hong Kong equities, the rise would be less. The investment return would not separate the realized and unrealized parts because we use the generally accepted accounting principles. If you look at our equities portfolio, I was looking at these figures. In fact, the volatility can be great. I have looked at 1994. Since that year, we have published our investment returns. If you look at the US S&P, there was a loss in 6 years. Some funds only invested in S&P, and starting from 1994, there would be losses in 6 years. And in other words, there was even a loss of 138% in 1 year. For exchange fund, 2008, that was the worst year, there was a loss of 5.6%. And compared to so-called equities funds, we of course also sustained losses, but then our losses were much lower than the general equities funds. Let me always remind ourselves of this. This is a statutory fund. It is not an investment fund. Our statutory aim is to maintain the stability of our currency. So that is our statutory responsibility, and that is why we are in a way hands tied when we go about our investment. We cannot just be like any private equity fund and look at just high, medium, and long-term returns. That is why we are in this situation. You talked about equities. This year, we have no crystal ball. We don't know whether S&P would repeat the performance of last year, i.e. 30% rise. There is a big question mark. Nobody can be certain about that. So whether it be equities or bonds, there are investment risks. Okay, if there are no other questions, that's it for this item. Thank you very much, Mr. Chen and your team. Next item on the agenda. Budget of the Securities and Futures Commission for the financial year 2014 to 2015. I'd like to welcome representatives from the SFC, and the administration has also prepared papers to introduce that budget to members. We do have a big team for this item, and the list of attendees has been distributed. I'd like to know whether it is for Ms. Selina Yan to speak first, and then Mr. Carlson Tong will speak on behalf of the SFC. Is that right? Ms. Yan, over to you. Thank you, Chairman. Members, the budget for SFC 2014-15, I think we have distributed a paper on that to members. In a moment, Mr. Carlson Tong will introduce the paper. But here, let me just say this. As an independent supervisory organization, the SFC should have financial stability for it to discharge its duties. But also as a public organization, the SFC should be cautious in using its resources, because after all, its income is from the market. And for the 2014-15 budget, we understand that in the coming year, the SFC is proposing to reduce the levies by 10% and also to extend the annualized license fee holiday by 2 years. At the same time, the SFC is proposing that within their budget, $20 million would be used to support manpower training for the industry. We welcome all those initiatives. At the same time, we know that within the budget of the SFC, the expenditure is going to rise. There would also be a rise in terms of manpower expenditure. We are now scrutinizing the budget of the SFC, and of course, we today would like to listen to members on their views. Now, may I hand over the floor to Mr. Carlson Tong. Mr. Tong, please. Honorable Chairman and members, good morning. First of all, could I wish you a very happy and prosperous year of the horse. Ms. Chairman, for the sake of Mr. Ashley Older, could I please be allowed to speak in English? No problem at all. Is it that your script has been prepared, and is it going to be distributed after you have spoken? Yes, certainly. Thank you.
Honourable members of the Financial Affairs Panel, I'm pleased to have the opportunity once again to brief honourable members of our budget. Before addressing any questions that honourable members may have, I would just like to take a few minutes to highlight the key elements in our budget. As an independent security regulator, our budget is formulated to ensure that we're adequately funded to discharge our regulatory duties and to achieve our statutory objectives. Our expected income and level reserves are bound to fluctuate during successive business cycles, and therefore they cannot dictate how we formulate our operating budget. Rather, our primary concern when determining our resource requirements is to deliver consistently efficient and effective regulatory outcomes for all those who participate in Hong Kong's rapidly developing markets. I shall return to the subject of reserves later. Honourable members have read from our budget submission that for 2014-15, we have a number of key initiatives which are crucial to achievement of essential regulatory objectives. This include, firstly, a more intensive and structured approach to supervision of the Hong Kong Stock Exchange. Secondly, the build-out of our new corporate regulation team to proactively detect and follow up on cases of misconduct by listed companies. And last but not least, shortening the time taken to process enforcement cases. All this requires resources, and our CEO, Mr. Ashley Alder, will be happy to answer any specific questions honourable members may have on this key initiative as well as other aspects of our budget after my introduction. Notwithstanding operating deficit, which is projected to be about $300 million for 2013-14 for this year, the SFC is mindful of the competitive environment facing some in the securities and futures industry, in particular the small and medium enterprise sector, the SME. As such, we are proposing to extend the licensing fee holiday for another 2 years. This will translate into loss of income over 2 years of about $340 million, and for 1 year, for this year, 2014-15 budget, the impact will be $170 million loss of income to SFC. But it will bring immediate financial relief to intermediaries and directly benefit the industry. And to continue to contribute towards the professional development of our intermediaries, we have also set aside $20 million in our 2014-15 budget to fund training initiatives, particularly programs for small and medium-sized firms. In proposing this measure, we of course need to be financially prudent in formulating our budget, and I will explain why I believe that we have achieved just the right balance. Now, returning to our reserves, we recognise this was a subject of discussion when we were here last year. We set our 2013-14 budget. We have explained that income is counter-cyclical. Reserves are built up when market activity is high to be used to bridge any funding gap, including any operating deficit when market activity is low. This ensures the SFC is adequately resourced to discharge its regulatory duties at all times without needing to resort to government funding. The SFC has not made any request for appropriation of government since 1993. The level of reserves we now have largely is the result of transaction levies collected during a period of very high market activity between 2006 and 2008. Since then, the levy rate has been reduced twice in recognition of the fact that we are able temporarily to shift part of our reliance on the levy as our primary source of funding to our reserves. In doing so, we're acutely aware of the importance of ensuring that we do not prematurely drain our reserves by using them as our main or only source of funding whilst allowing operating deficit to balloon. This would be financially irresponsible. It is crucial that we take a balanced approach which helps defer any future requirement to reverse previous levy reductions, and also to ensure that there is little or no prospect of needing to seek funding from the government. I should point out here that the original levy rate of 0.005%, which was in place before this reduction, would have ensured that we would not run an operating deficit. Last year, the SFC committed to conduct a comprehensive review of its financial position. We have done so and proposed, while bearing in mind our funding sources and needs, to further reduce our levy rate by 10% to 0.20027%. Based on the estimated average daily turnover of $65 billion, that would translate into annual income foregone by the SFC in a sum of $97 million. Assuming that the reduction in levy takes effect from October this year, the levy income foregone for 2014-15 will be about $49 million. If we press ahead with the licensing fee holiday and the levy reduction, the total foregone income for SFC for 2014-15 and 2015-16 is projected to be approximately $220 million and $270 million, respectively. An SFC operating deficit will increase to $509 million for our budget year 2014-15. The overall reserve at the end of 2014-15 are expected to drop to $6.6 billion, approximately four times our annual operating expenditure. If our operating deficit continues at that rate, our reserve are projected to shrink to around two times our annual operating expenditure in 3 years' time. By then, the SFC will need to revisit its options to ensure adequate funding, including a possibility of raising levy rate. Finally, I would just like to reassure and assure honourable members that the SFC is fully committed to upholding the quality of our capital market, the protection of investors in Hong Kong, and effective enforcement action against all wrongdoers. We'll be happy to answer any questions the honourable members may have on our budget. Thank you very much.
現在有三位、四位、五位、六位、六位議員，仲有七位議員表示要發言，咁我建議都係維持翻三分鐘。副主席
6 members have raised their hand to speak, 3 minutes each, please. Thank you, Madam Chair. For providing the two-year of annual license fee holiday, I would want to express my welcome to that. The SFC is responding to the industry and respects the industry, and this is a benefit to the industry. It is not only that, but really it is a very meaningful response from the SFC towards the industry. And this is a breakthrough from the practice of lack of communication between the SFC and the industry, which was in the past. In the future, I look forward to be able to reflect our views directly to the SFC. This is a good thing. I'm looking at the budget. I'm looking at the paper, paragraph 18 there. It talks about the manpower. And very often there are criticisms that the market is not sufficiently regulated. And I think it is a good thing that the that there should be more staff for the SFC. And I see that there are 51 posts to be added, but mostly these posts are not in a corporate finance area of the SFC, but rather in intermediaries regulation. And I am worried, therefore, is the SFC trying to allocate more of these additional staff to intermediaries regulation? Is it because there are some new and stringent measures coming out targeting the intermediaries? Can the SFC perhaps respond to that? Why is most of the new staff allocated to intermediaries regulation? Thank you very much, Vice Chairman, for your positive assessment of our work. As for staff allocation, if I can ask Ashley Arder to answer your question.
Glad to. I mean, so far as our approach to intermediaries are concerned, and the basic approach is that all firms, no matter large or small, must be subject to appropriate supervision. And we must take account of the different risks posed by both. I'd also point out that one of our recent, and in my view, significant publications was a risk review, actually of very large firms, that was published in December, only a couple of months ago. So far as the headcount is concerned and its deployment, if you look at it in detail, it involves an additional 8 which are in corporate finance. That's really about listed company regulation, which I can expand on if members wish. We've got another 6 in enforcement and 8 in legal services. That's really about ensuring that our investigations are completed quicker than they are now. There are an additional 5 in investment products, which is really about projects such as the open-ended fund companies and also mutual recognition across of funds. And then finally, supervision of markets, which is 9 people, which is more to do with supervision of the exchange. So if you look at that, there's 36 of 51 altogether, which are dealing with areas that actually are not to do with intermediaries. And the increase in intermediaries is in large part to do with the expected, or the past and expected increase in licensing applications.
好 ，OK， 下一位系梁繼昌议员。
多谢主席。 大家睇翻 Security and Futures Commission 嗰个 budget 咧，十月廿四号嗰份文件咧，我想睇翻嗰个。
I'm looking at the October 24th document financials, income and expenditure statement. That's on page 17. I know for the budget of this year, the staff cost. We have already heard that there will be more staff cost this year to the tune of 17.8% additional. And another item with relative larger increase is professional and others. That's 14.8% more. Now, since the SFC has already hired so many people internally, why does it have to incur so much professional fees? That is the first question. And the second question is, members of the LegCo and the people of Hong Kong are not clear about the division of labor between the SFC and the stock exchange in terms of supervision. Listed company supervision, you said that you need to beef that up, but the stock exchange has its own regulatory team for listed companies. The last thing I want to see is that there are things that fall between the cracks between the stock exchange and the SFC, and I also do not want to see any overlapping. Can you give us something that is easy to understand and also clear as to listed company supervision starting from IPO to post-listing? The division of labor between the SFC and the stock exchange, how exactly do you go about it? That's the first and second question. The third question, paragraph 5.1, funding to external parties. There is a Financial Reporting Council funding. I'd like to know whether this is a long-term commitment. Because I think for FRC funding, I think in the long run should be funded by the listed companies and not by the SFC itself. Three questions, please. Yes, we thank Mr. Leung for the questions. For the first two questions, perhaps Mr. Ashley Alder would answer the questions.
Short answer, if you can give a written document to supplement, because it is one of the requests from
I'll keep
Mr. Leung.
As short as I can. So the item about professional and others is mainly a reflection of the fact that we have more enforcement cases, we have more investigations, and they tend to be more complex, and therefore the degree to which we brief out to counsel to present in court and other tribunals has increased. That's the fundamental reason. So far as the exchange and the SFC Division of Labor is concerned for listed companies, it boils down to the exchange supervising in relation to compliance with listing rules, which are the exchange's rules, and us looking at listed companies from the angle of the SFO, the Securities and Futures Ordinance, and breaches of the SFO. So under that, there should be no overlap between the two, but clearly we need to coordinate. I think that deals with those two questions.
Okay, then will you
Can you please provide a written document to supplement your answer, please?
Second question.
Sure.
Okay, thank you. 主席，唔该。或者我好快答答阿梁议员关于个F.
As for the FRC funding, you remember at the start, it was agreed that there were four parties to shoulder the fund, the government, the stock exchange, the SFC, and also the Society of Accountants. And basically, this is to investigate companies and also do spot checks as to whether the reporting is up to par and accounting standards. As you know, there is a consultation concerning in the future whether the Society of Accountants would be, if they think that this is not independent, that is to say the FRC may take this over, and the cost allocation at that time may be different from what it is now. Mr. James Tien. Madam Chair, of course, as an international financial centre, the operation of the market should be regulated and well regulated. The SFC regulates the financial market in Hong Kong, but we do see that there is more and more stringent regulation, and there is not a lot of help provided to the market and the practitioners. That's also true of the government. I'm looking at the SFC's budget with all the staffing and in particular over 50 posts to be added. The SFC have been performing so well and there have been no incidents last year. And why are you adding 51 staff? Mr. Cheung, our vice chairman, seems to be concerned. The major securities firms, international firms operating in Hong Kong, of course, they will have the people to entertain your regulatory staff, but for the small to medium-sized firms, in terms of their responsibilities in compliance with the listing, with the laws, etc., and the ordinances, would that be adding to their burden? And also, I see that you have 7.1 billion in terms of reserves, even if you have a deficit of 500 million with that kind of reserves. This will see you through for at least 10 years. But I heard just now that the chairman said that this will only last you 2 to 3 years. Why is that? I do not understand. Yes. We thank Mr. James Teen for the question. Now, after the international financial crisis, different countries in the Europe area and the U.S. through IOSCO had set up a lot of new changes to the regulatory structure. If Hong Kong is to continue to participate in international financial dealings as an international financial center, we will have to be up to par. For example, OTC derivatives is already an international requirement, and we have to abide by those. Ashley, would you want to supplement? Ashley, please.
Yes, and I'd just like to pick up the point about effectively, I think the assistance to smaller firms, effectively, and that's is something we take seriously. We are in constant dialogue with the smaller end of the industry, and we understand some of the pressures they're under. Specifically, in this budget, we have two main items, one which was referred to earlier, which is the license fee holiday, which is effectively financial assistance. And the second is ring-fencing a part of our reserves, currently $20 million, effectively for training. And that's for the provision of training courses for SMEs, simply because, I think as you say rightly, they don't have the same resources as large firms do to adapt and to train internally.
With regard to the reserves, the chairman, would you like to respond?
Yes, certainly. As I introduced just now, by the end of 2014-15, our reserves would drop to $6.6 billion because we are going to reduce the levy and the deficit would be $500 million this year. And if we do not make any changes, the reserves will continue to drop. So you can see that we are going to have our reserves reduced by $500-600 million year by year. And after the 2014-15 budget and 3 years down the road, we would only have reserves for 2 years' expenditure. The SFC must maintain its independence. Even if the market fluctuates, even if there is volatility, we still have to work because it is exactly then that we have to do the most. We need to have enough reserves for our operation. And under the SFO, we have a lot of duties to discharge. And that is extremely important. No, I think you still have 7 billion. And that would last you 14 years if you have it drop by half a billion every year. Sorry, I did not hear you. You have 7 billion in reserve. You are having it reduced by 500 million every year, so that would last you through 14 years. Why are you saying that it will be depleted in 2-3 years? No, by the end of the 2014-15 year, it will be reduced to 6.6 billion. So why do you say it will be depleted in 2-3 years? No, I'm saying that after 2-3 years, there will be reserves to cover
2 years' expenditure. Our yearly expenditure is $1.6 billion, and under the SFO, it is said that if our reserves should be more than 2 years' expenditure, then we need to look at it with the FS to see the level of levy. So the 2 years' expenditure reserve is an indicator so that the SFC has enough reserves for our operation. We are saying that we should have reserves to cover 2 years' expenditure. Well, yes, if you are spending $1.6 billion this year, you may be spending $2 billion in the year after, so you will be depleting your reserves. Mr. James Toh, I'd like to follow up on the question of Mr. James Tin, but I don't represent the constituency as Mr. Christopher Cheung does. You are now reducing the levy by 10%. I like that as a beginning, but I think it is too conservative. First of all, you are assuming that in 6A, that the daily turnover would be $65 billion. I think that is extremely conservative. And you are talking about a deficit of $500, $600 million. And I assume, like you do, that the daily turnover is $65 billion. Well, even after 3 years, your reserve would not come down to $3.2 billion. It is impossible. So the 10% reduction is really a very small and conservative reduction. Well, yes, as an organization, you want to act cautiously and you don't want to have to increase the levy later on. But then given the ordinance, if you do not have enough money, the council here would have the responsibility to allow you to increase the levy so that you preserve your independence and financial robustness. But okay, never mind. You have this beginning. You are reducing it by 10%, but I hope you will continue to review the situation in the coming 2 years. If your assumption of $65 billion is found to be inaccurate, if you have less expenditure in other aspects, then in the coming year, you should reduce the levy by a bigger margin. You should not just say, I have to keep the reserve at four times, five times our yearly expenditure. I can tell you frankly that in the coming few years, you will still have your reserves covering 3 to 4 years' expenditure. I think that is not right. When there is time for you to get a bigger levy, then you should ask the market players to do so. But then you should not just always prepare for so-called rainy days all the time. And that is why you should keep the situation under review. I hope that in the coming 2 years, you will keep this under review because I will be chasing up on you every year. Mr. Tong, thank you, Mr. Toh. You are totally correct. Our reserves are dynamic. It is not static. Our plan is that if it is more than 4 years' expenditure, then we will have to do something. But you are very correct. If the turnover is going to be much bigger than our estimate, we will certainly review the situation. I agree with you. Every year, we take a close look at the situation and then we will explain why we do certain things. Next one, Mr. Ng Leung Sing. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to thank your introduction. I'd like to follow up on an issue in the budget. We are very concerned about the manpower plan and the increase of 51 new posts. Because, in fact, it is a big increase. I'd like to know more about the Legal Services Division and the Enforcement Division. Is there any duplication of work between these two? One is on litigation, the other one on investigation. But here it says that the Enforcement Division is to address the need for more staff to provide support for resource-intensive work. I'd like to know what you mean by resource-intensive work. This is a question, and also the forecast, $65 billion turnover, that may be an underestimation because there is an increase in the MPF market and mainland investors may also come to Hong Kong, and then IPOs, you are looking at big accounts And also, if you do good supervision, investors will have more confidence in you and there will be more of them. So shouldn't you make a more accurate estimate, Mr. Tong or Mr. Ashley? Mr. Ashley, please.
In relation to turnover, I completely agree with you. I think it would be a good outcome if turnover is higher. But for budgeting purposes, we've been relatively conservative because I think we need to be for proper budgeting planning. But if it turns out that turnover increases over the next few months and years, we would then have to have another look at the balance of our funding between levy and reserves. That's clear. In relation to the headcount, and in particular enforcement and legal services, the headcount for enforcement is mainly junior posts to handle document-intensive work in the course of investigations. The job that's done by legal services, there is no overlap because legal services operates effectively as our internal law firm to provide advice, normally near the end of an investigation, and advice effectively on next steps to take, venue, whether we should be going to market misconduct tribunal, etc. Now, it was recognized that our investigation process overall and enforcement process was becoming too lengthy. And one of the blockages was effectively a problem with resourcing in legal services. So the reason why we have 8 in legal services is to create a new litigation, an additional litigation team for that purpose.
Hey.
Next one, Mr. Chen Kin Po. Thank you, Chairman. The SFC is increasing its manpower, but we have to understand that there will also be a compliance cost for the industry when there are new requirements. I'd like you to tell me whether you have a balanced supervision and business operation, because you have more products, then also the industry will also benefit, and if you are flexible in allowing new products, then business will be helped. So how do you strike a balance between supervision and people's business? And number 2, para 8 of the paper, at the investment products division, you add 5 posts to support work relating to mainland Hong Kong fund mutual recognition. But in recent years, mainlanders invest in Hong Kong, and they are investing in insurance and other commercial products. So I'd like to know whether the new post would be enough to tackle the mainland demand for Hong Kong products. If there is a higher demand, would you add more manpower to that division? Mr. Tong, again, can I ask Mr. Alder Ashley to answer, please?
I mean, in relation to, I think, the question of new rules, which is a potential burden on industry, our basic approach is to be pretty conservative when it comes to introducing new rules, because we know that new rules give rise to compliance burdens. But what we do in relation to the rules that we do have is take the supervision and enforcement of those rules really, really seriously. That's our overall approach. I think in relation to effectively market development issues in relation to products, I think I absolutely agree with you. At the moment, some of the headcount that we put into investment products is around the mutual recognition project to do with cross-border fund offerings. But going forwards, if, as you say, the demand increases, we would have to review that, without doubt. So I agree.
So you mean they're actually, how do you strike the balance between, as you just mentioned, you're also very serious about how you can ensure that all these regulatory requirements are really necessary. Mm-hmm. But the problem is, if you have so many people, there are definitely more staff would be, they have to, I don't know, I would say they would copy from everywhere in the world and then impose in Hong Kong. But the problem is, for every rule, new rule that comes out, there will be a compliance cost. I'm always concerned about how do you make sure that there's a right balance.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think we always bear that in mind. I mean, our overall approach is that there shouldn't be a conflict between the way in which we operate to protect investors and the development of the market. Because after all, we're after a quality market, so there shouldn't be any conflict. And when we discuss the formation of new rules, that's the principle we bear in mind.
Right,
next one is my turn. Just now, Mr. Tong mentioned that this year you have a new arrangement whereby you would provide manpower training for the industry. I'd like to know your plan in this aspect, because I'm aware that SMEs are facing a lot of difficulties. Yes, our financial market is expanding, but SMEs may not be benefiting as much. So will you be tackling SMEs and do something? What is the progress? Number two, manpower increase. I think many members, especially those from the business sector, have mentioned this. You are adding 51 posts.
And we have to strike a balance. Hong Kong is an international financial center. We have a very good regulator, but on the other hand, the industry is concerned because you have been adding headcount over a number of years. For any organization to add headcount year on year, I think it would only be understandable that the industry is concerned about that. And I do understand that this is not because you have a lot of reserve and therefore you are adding headcount for adding headcount, but the industry remains concerned what they will be doing and some of your considerations behind adding these headcount and what kind of work they will be undertaking, these new staff. And the small to medium firms have also said that, yes, they support your assistance, but this is not to train them so that they can switch professions or move into other industries. So what are the plans there? Thank you, Madam Chair. If I can just very quickly respond to your questions and then Ashley can provide the details. First of all, on education and training. Even though we plan to work with the Hong Kong Securities Investment in providing training. The Hong Kong, the institution is basically responsible for providing education in preparation for professional exams. And we are already talking to them as to how they can provide more training on new rules and regulations and also new products. I think most of the beneficiaries are small to medium-sized firms personnel because the larger firms will have their internal resources. They do not need this kind of training assistance. So this is really geared towards the small to medium-sized firms. As for staffing, again, please alleviate your concerns. We do not add staff just for the sake of it. We are very clear as to what we're trying to achieve. Ashley, can you perhaps
know why you need to increase 51?
Sure. Yes. It's a good question, and it demands an explanation. The 51 posts, I think we've tried to be, I think, very clear in the budget as to how we are deploying them. They're all to do with specific projects or challenges that we have identified which we believe need to be addressed. And I'll give you just three examples. One I've mentioned already, so I won't go into it, which is ensuring that our enforcement and investigations process is efficient. The reason that's really important is that both from the perspective of the investigation itself and also from the perspective of those being investigated, they shouldn't take too long. That's very clear. So that's one aspect. The second aspect is we've said something in the, we've said a little in the budget and also publicly about our determination to become more active around the regulation of and supervision of listed companies. So that's another important topic which we believe where we need to have a headcount. And finally, we've also mentioned the supervision of the stock exchange. A revamped approach to exchange supervision is really a response to, firstly, developing international norms, but also a response to the fact that the exchange in Hong Kong is developing into a vertically integrated multi-asset exchange. It is more complex. It acquired LME, for example. So from that perspective, we have no choice, and we must structure our supervision of the exchange along different lines.
Oh, 我想请你们都是谨慎啦。
Please be prudent. If you have to add staff, of course you will have to. But on the other hand, I do observe in the past years that you have added considerable staff, and also your regulations are also becoming more stringent and of higher standards. And also for training fund, would you please respond to the needs of the training needs of the small to medium-sized firms, given the introduction of new products and regulations. Anything else, members? If there are no further questions, we close this agenda item here. Thank you very much for coming up. Yes, we now go to the next agenda item, which is construction of West Kowloon government offices. Because this is a public works item, we have also invited other members as well as the administration, which have already provided a paper concerning the construction of the West Kowloon government offices details. Would you please refer to the paper? Today, representing the administration is Mr. Yong Tuk Kung, Deputy Secretary for Financial Services and Treasury, Mr. Alan Siu, Government Property Administrator, Mr. Yang Chang Man, Senior Property Manager, Projects and Special Duties, Mrs. Sylvia Lam, Project Director, Architectural Services Department, Ms. Monica Lam, Chief Project Manager, Architectural Services Department. Mr. Yeung, can you bring us through the paper, please? Yes. It is the government's policy to accommodate its offices in government-owned properties as circumstances permit and relocate non-location-bound government offices out of high-value areas. We propose that in order to provide more premises for lease in the urban areas. We propose the West Kowloon government offices on a site of about 10,000 square meters and comprising two blocks of 16 and 18 stories respectively, and with a construction floor area of around 50,500 meters square and 115,000 meters square respectively, and an underground car park. Basically, we are looking at some $150 million in rental savings expenditure. And the offices will be to accommodate a number of departments, five departments in total. They are now housed in the Yamate and the Wan Chai offices. And they will be moved in order to make way for the MTR line and also for the three government buildings projects. And also in the West Kowloon government office, we will have a student health center and also a government dental clinic. And we will start the tendering process early this year and in 2015 come back to the Finance Committee for financial disbursement. And we hope to, by phases, complete the project in 2018 and 2019. We're looking at the cost for the WKGO project. Basically, it would be 30,000 to 35,000 per meter square, and that is more or less the same as the West Kowloon Law Court. And we'll be looking at third quarter 2013 costs. We are looking at 5 billion plus, and during the process of construction, we will be providing the funding and the budget during the construction process, and the total would be amounting to about 6 billion. billion dollars. But during the tender period, when we get the design plans and also during the process, we will have more accurate budgeting, and we will be coming back to the Public Works Committee and panel and also the Finance Committee for further funding approval. And we will be continue to monitor the project so as to make sure that it is cost effective. Questions, please. Mr. James Tien. The Liberal Party is in support of this project. If we're talking about pricey urban areas such as areas in Wan Chai, whether it is for sale, for other usage, it would be appropriate to move the government offices from these sites to the West Kowloon area. But looking at the RTHK headquarters, some people question why parties such as ours object to these proposals. And we're looking at construction cost of $33,000 per meter square. And that seems reasonable. But we're talking about a floor area of 115,000 meters square. Madam Chair, I'm also in the industry of real estate. And if we compare this to the RTHA headquarters project, theirs is a BOT project. And my question to the government is, why do you not leave this to the commercial sector? And that is, you can invite tendering from the industry, and if it exceeds $5 billion, we would support that. But you are not doing that. What you are doing is to come to the Let's Show asking for $5 billion, and if that is known to the construction industry, of course, they would come up with a tender to that particular budget extent. I mean, should we not consider BOT, or should we be looking at the practice in the industry whereby we look for the architects, the engineers, and the mechanical and electrical engineers, etc., and ourselves? Well, concerning BOT, to answer your question, according to my experience, it would not be more expensive than other ways of going about it. Perhaps I should ask our buildings department colleagues to answer that question. Well, Madam Chair, there are 2 points there. First of all, the cost, construction cost, and also the mode of the contract. In terms of construction cost, we are talking about just over 30,000 Hong Kong dollars as unit cost. As mentioned just now, altogether, that would be about $6 billion in total. But this is really a very preliminary estimate. We will have to look at the market response. As for the design and construction and purchase, in fact, we have invited all qualified contractors to come for the tender. So this is a competitive tender, and we have information to indicate that for traditional designed and tender process, the cost is more or less the same. But of course, we have to take out the design cost element from the tender. Yes, we also believe that different models will have their advantages and their limitations. As for the West Kowloon Government Office project, we have selected this particular mode because it, in our mind, it saves us time in terms of construction, because there are certain government offices which will be moved to the West Kowloon Government Office in order to save on rentals. And the reason why there is time saved is because it is a team, that is the construction team and the design team are coordinated. So the design and some of the construction can actually start in tandem. That is an advantage. And in fact, I have responded to similar questions before, so I will not go into further details. Madam Chair, if I may pursue, perhaps because I am in the industry of real estate myself, I'm not in agreement with the government's point of view. You know, anybody within the industry would want to be as efficient as possible in the construction projects, and we do hire our own architects and our engineers, and we go to the buildings department, and we get basically we go full steam ahead and be as efficient as possible. I do not see how this particular building model will save time. And really, when we talk about the budget, if it exceeds, you're asking for basically five billion, and the industry would definitely come to you with a tender with that in mind. I mean, it is like a company saying openly that the board of directors have already approved a budget of 5 billion, so come and get it. It amounts to basically that. So since you already have the concept and the specifications of two buildings, 16 stories and 18 stories respectively, and whatever floor area, and this is nothing particular, this is but a regular office building, and given that, why are you insisting on BOT and not utilizing the expertise in the industry? I mean, the tendering process, it is a practice in the industry, basically awards the tender to the lowest bidder. Why do you have to adhere to this particular budget and this particular model?
Yes, I have also heard that people put in their bids having their eyes on the budget approved by LegCo. I think that is understandable, but you have to be careful. I don't think we can always support an exceedance in expenditure later on. Your answer for Mr. Tin, please. Yes, Chairman. Government capital projects are very transparent. We always give an account to the LegCo and the public about the pricing of the projects, the construction cost and the unit cost. Can always be made open. That has been done for previous projects. Now we are making an estimate basing on previous projects. This is just an estimate. Therefore, the project estimate now should not impact on the tender prices. Later on, when can we save time? Please go for your tendering exercise first and then come back to PWSC, and then we can support your lowest tender. Why do you do it the other way around? You say it is transparent because you are telling the whole world that $5 billion have been secured, and so they will not put in bids worth $4.5 billion. I understand you are going for transparency, but this is too transparent. The whole wide world will know that $5 billion have been approved by LegCo, and which developer would say they can do it for $4.5 billion? Thank you for that question. We are now providing an estimate of the project to LegCo. Tendering has not been done. We are going to have a competitive tender. We will vet all the bids and the prices therein. And after that, when we have decided to recommend a bid, then we will apply for funding from the LegCo. And it is expected that we will go to the PWSC only in 2015. At this, what exactly? I know what you are doing. I'm saying that you should do it the other way around. In fact, so you are going to look at the bids before you seek funding approval. Okay, it's time for me to speak. The DAB will support the project. As Mr. James Tien said, we also advocated that government offices should be removed from CBDs. You can save rental, and at the same time, you can release office land for the business sector. I hope you will continue to look for suitable sites. In fact, we have been talking about the three government towers in Wan Chai, but even now, you have not got any concrete plans to move them. I understand the difficulties, but nevertheless, please continue to look for sites. And I have also said many times that I'm concerned about possible overspending. I cannot say exactly why government projects should have this problem of overspending. It is quite often. You always tell us that prices have escalated. However, I think you need to do a review, or else electrical councillors would find it extremely difficult to always support you when you come back for supplementary funding. I'd like to know whether you have done any internal review. Well, this is a relatively small project, but when you do come for funding support, I hope you would have done your review. I have heard from industry this, and maybe this is not right, but they say government projects are always expensive because you set high standards. And now there is a lack of manpower in the construction sector. But if you are in the private sector, the overspending is always by a high percentage. The boss will not allow it, and you will have to think of ways and means to tackle this. One of the ways to do it is to go for a fixed price contract. The developer may have a bigger gain, but then in the end, you will not have to come back for a big supplementary provision. Thank you, Chairman, for those questions. One, the three government towers at Wan Chai Waterfront, we are working very hard on it. I think Mr. Seal can comment in a moment. Secondly, overspending or increase in budget estimate. We are very concerned about this as well, you know, because of inflation and the overall economic situation. There has been an increase in project costs in the past few years. The engineering departments of the government have been very careful in controlling costs. Recently, we did a briefing at the PWSC, and we took a look at the last 10 years. There have been 600-odd capital works projects, and only a minority had to seek supplementary funding, or just 3.4%. So it is not a big number. However, there are many large projects coming on stream. The Development Bureau is now reviewing how we can better control costs and do more accurate estimates. In the next Development Bureau meeting or panel meeting, there will be a briefing to be done by the Bureau. I believe more detailed information will be supplied then. You mean the development panel will receive the report? Maybe not all members are members of the panel. Perhaps you can distribute the report to all members. I believe this is a common concern in the council. Well, we are not exactly talking about the Wan Chai Towers, so please just be brief. Yes, Chairman, about the relocation or reprovisioning of the three government towers. It is going to be a massive project because we are talking about 29 departments with 11,000 civil servants, or an area of 175,000 square meters. In fact, this WKGO will be used also for the reprovisioning of those three towers. We expect that after WKGO is built, we'll continue to build other GOs step by step to reprovision departments in those three towers. We understand that members would like us to release the land ASAP for the private sector. Therefore, we are not going to wait till we move everybody out from the three towers before we launch the land in the market. We will not put in new office workers when we move out the existing departments. In fact, we will start to lease out the premises once we start to move out staff. But do you have a timetable? This has been on the drawing board for too many years. At the WKGO, we are talking about completing it in 2018, 2019. So some people will be moved to WKGO from Wan Chai starting from that year, and we are going to release some of the premises to the private sector. Okay, I'll ask you the same question next time. That's it for this item, if there are no other questions. Since this item has to do with the submission of funding request to the PWSC and also to the FC, do you object to that being done? If not, we note the process. And that's it for this item. Thank you very much. Anything else under AOB? If not, the next meeting is going to be held on the 7th of April. Thank you very much. Thank you all.